we have guest lectures. I mean, we have the first lecture by Alexander Rick, but our aim for during this week was finding some interesting guest lecturers that are is linked with the theme of the workshop. And one of the things when we were thinking about lecturers is that Stuttgart has a big history in this kind of making membrane structures in special engineering with Freilotto and the different institutes. So one of the things we did is contacting at least the ITTA to see if there's a possible interesting collaboration possible. And the person I was talking to was going to lecture. It was not possible, but he suggested me Julian Leinhard. And we had a talk, and I think his work is quite interesting, matching the topic about kinetic architecture and structures. He did his PhD at the university, where he also was specifically about, partly about the active bending structures. I think he will be also showing that. And he currently has his own office, like a structure, that is, I think, interesting in this line of this special type of engineering firms that Stuttgart has produced. So welcome. And
thank you.
Go ahead.
Cool. Yeah, good evening. I'll talk about these two subjects of kinematics and kinetics. I'll kind of show you a couple of projects, a little bit of background information. It'll be mixed work from when I worked at SL Rasch before I started my PhD, and part of my research work, and then stuff we do currently at the office. And yeah, interrupt any time, we can have a discussion along the way, anything you don't understand or want to know more about, just say stop and we'll talk about it a bit more. As I said, I'll give you a little bit of theoretical background every now and then about some particular aspects, and then we will look at project work as well. Now the first thing that we like to differentiate is the difference between kinematics and kinetics, in which kinematics is the law of movement, where you solidly focus on the geometry. So you have rigid linked mechanisms, you have discrete hinges, and you can, by pure means of geometry, you can define the movement within the system. When you look at kinetics, you add the aspect of mass, so you add the physics of the system to it. And when we talk about elastic kinetics, when we talk about systems that can move, that may have some discrete hinges, but they also move from elastic deformation. And I'll kind of show you some work we did in kinematic structures, which we designed solidly by means of geometric reasoning. And then I'll show you a large body of work from this aspect of elastic kinetics and the overall subject of bending active structures, which is essentially designing with material behavior, because you're designing with the flexibility of the systems. My background in kinematic structures is, as I mentioned in the beginning, I worked for quite a long time and still am working for Bodo Rasch in his office. And they are very famous for these kinematic umbrella structures. These are projects that have been developed over a very, very long time. In the time of Freilotto in the 60s, they were already developing the first kind of tulip-shaped funnel umbrellas. And they've been optimized and redesigned and over-designed again and again to arrive at the kind of largest project built so far in 2008. 2011, these umbrellas for the mosque in Medina. I was quite fortunate that when I started working at Bodo Rasch's office as a structural engineer, they had just gotten the job to do these umbrellas for Medina. So that's where I learned everything about these kinematic systems, form finding of these structures, and the analysis of it. And it all goes very closely hand in hand. So when you look at these kinematics of these systems, these are actually very simple umbrella kinematics that you know from the standard umbrella that you're working with. And all of them are designed based on one very simple rule, which I can show you in this little animation. You basically take the two reference positions of your arms, you locate a hinge on it and connect it, and by defining the bisector between two hinges on your system, you can complete the kinematics. So you have the blue beam is the initial state, the pink one is the state that you're aiming for, and you just locate hinges on the system, and then what you're looking for is the driving arm of it. And just by connecting it, the hinges with the bisector, and then along the bisector you can place the third hinge. This is the very standard rule that any car, cabriolet car roofs, or any of these kinematics, winglets in airplanes, they're all based on this very simple bisector rule, which is something that's super easily implemented in any parametric tool, and then you can go ahead and design 2D kinematics. Gets a little bit more complicated with these double folded arm systems. These are kind of lent from these double folding umbrellas you get as well. You know, you get the large one where you have a very large package and one single hinge in it, and then you get these double hinge systems, again lent from these smaller rain umbrellas. And you basically do this system if you want to control the height at which it's closing. So if you want to make sure that this height is controllable and the overall package of the umbrella stays fairly small, then you have to add another hinge, basically double folding the main arm. Because controlling the bottom height means that you don't kill anyone when the umbrella is closing, and controlling the top height is kind of making sure that you don't have a super large tower when it's closed. So any umbrella roughly with a span more than 16 meters will have this double hinge system, because otherwise the package will just simply become too large. Now, because these systems have to be designed very slender, so every beam is really dimensioned down to the bare minimum, they also have fairly large deflections. So you have this umbrella with these arms sticking out, then you have a membrane tensioning down the bottom, and that membrane actually exerts a vertical force on the arm end. So what you'll have here is you have to design the kinematics of the systems super elevated to the actual eave height that you want to design. And you add the membrane, you do the foam finding, and that flexes these arms down so that at the end you have an equilibrium system that defines the eave's height that was architecturally aimed at. This actually means that you have to do a very long iteration between designing the kinematics, finding the actual dimensions, the cross sections of the arms, then doing the membrane form finding, and only then will you know how much does the arm deflect. Then you do structural analysis, redesign the arm, deflections change, you have to do the kinematics again. So you have to go loop over loop over loop until you have arms that are dimensioned to a degree that they're structurally sound, and that you know the deflections, and from the deflections you know how much higher you have to design the kinematics so that when it's deflected, it's where you want it to be. That's why my first kind of contact with parametric design was making a parametric tool that helps you design these umbrellas. So you had like, this is Excel based, this is before Grasshopper time. So we had this mask where you could put in the kind of boundary geometry, and then it would, based on this bisector rule, would kind of derive the geometry of the main arms of the system. And then the first thing that you always want to know, what are the kind of internal ratios in the kinematics? Because you're moving this arm up with a piston right down the center, and the reaction movement you get at the arm end can be very nonlinear. So even if you drive the system at the same speed, the arm end might make a huge move in the beginning and move very slowly through the center, and then at the end do an abrupt closing. And you need to optimize this, which this parametric tool did, by internally placing the hinges intelligently. Then there was other aspects, you know, there's arms that go in the diagonal, that go in the bisector of the system. Then we have these so-called passive arms that just swing out with the tensioning of the membrane. And then you can optimize the pre-stress ratios in the membrane so that every arm is only loaded in its normal direction, so you have no bending in the system. And eventually you send out the information into your FEM program. So that's kind of the first steps in parametric design that we did. And here it was clearly the necessity. Parametric design didn't help us come up with a very complex geometry. The typology was totally given. We knew exactly what we wanted to do. And we needed parametrics to link several design environments. We needed to link the CAD environment with the form-finding environment and the structural analysis environment, and use this parametric setup to kind of move faster through iterations. And you'll see that that's something that we do a lot in the office. Even now with Grasshopper, we don't necessarily use it to build very complex and kind of differentiated geometries. But also, if we do something that may look fairly standard, it really helps to connect different design environments and do iterations at a faster pace. A couple of images from the finished umbrellas, 26 meters span. There's two heights at which they're located, so they're overlapping. That also says why it's so important that you control the height where it is. You know, if it was one solitary umbrella, you could say, well, whether it's deflecting a little bit or not, I don't really care. Here it was very important that we could foresee the actual heights. Another aspect, and this then again has a lot to do with the way we connect different design environments, is the aspect of loading the structure. Normally in the codes we get wind loads for very standard buildings, and then the code will always say if your geometry is more complex you have to do wind tunnel tests. Now with membranes we have the problem that we do a wind tunnel test at a scale of about 1 to 100. Now the real membrane is 1 millimeter thick, and if you were downscaling it to the 1 to 100 model, you definitely have a scaling error. Especially so because you have to place these pressure valves within the membrane, so actually you're building a membrane in the wind tunnel that's 3 millimeters thick. So you're totally off scale. And also the membrane in the wind tunnel is rigid, whereas what you see here, it's in reality constantly changing its shape. So we found that this numeric wind analysis, which is something that there are no codes for and that is very, very seldomly done, is actually much closer to reality in this case. And we found that we have to take these kind of analysis measures to make sure that we are as close as possible to the real physics of the system, to then allow us to build the system as light as possible. That's obviously only possible with an umbrella project where you build 220 of the same. You have a very long design phase and very huge budget. But having had the chance to develop all of this now enables us to use the same methodologies on any other project. Gives you an impression of the system again. So here you can see the closed umbrella. People enjoying even that last little bit of shade that gives. And then you have the two different heights of these umbrellas. There's a couple of tiny little bit of detail that I can kind of make you look at that kind of tells you a little bit about this interconnection between form and structure that we have in these membrane systems. Earlier on I was just mentioning in passing that this parametric tool optimized the pre-stress ratios in the membrane. Now what I was saying is that when you look at the floor plan of this kinematic system, you have these so-called passive arms. These are simply connected by a hinge to these main arms, and they have no driving system to open them. So the only reason why these arms spread out and open is because of the tension in the membrane edge. Because you have a belt woven in here, and that has a very high tension. Now what you want to make sure is that the resultant force between these two edges points not perpendicular to the edge, but actually points in the direction of that passive arm. Because only when the resultant force points into the direction of the arm is it going to swing into place and have pure normal force as a load. And we can control this by varying the curvature of this edge. So you will see here that this one has a much larger radius than this one. a larger radius means more tension. So you'll actually see that this edge has a higher tensile force than this one, and resultantly the force goes in that direction. Yeah? So you can actually see it. We can't hide it, because there's an inseparable connection between form and forces in the system. And you can actually, if you look at it, you might wonder, whoa, these edges are differently curved. And they're differently curved for a reason, and that reason is connected to the kinematics of the system. And that's actually all the fun of it. That's, you know, that's when you really enjoy being a structural engineer, working with the form, working with the architects together, discussing how the form should look like, designing the kinematics of the system, making that feed information back into the form finding and back into the structural analysis, and then this kind of thing that's totally interconnected comes out of it. It goes even further. You see these ornamentics of this membrane surface, and they as well are not just applied as pure decoration. We always intentionally apply these ornamentics in a way that they strengthen the membrane surface where it's needed. So if I just go back two slides, you see these patches here, and you'll see in the folding arm, they lie right here where the membrane is tensioned up when it's folding, so it's actually giving it a little bit of extra strength where there's that point load. And then also you will always have stress concentrations right down the bottom, so we're also doubling up the material there. So it's really this intention to connect the form, the structure, the materiality and everything, kind of putting into a functional integration of one system. One very critical question in the design of these systems is always the intermediate stage. So all of these umbrellas are designed to take maximum load in their open position, because we have to assume that at some extreme case the motors don't work, there's a big storm coming and we can't close the umbrella. So they're all designed for maximum wind load. But a very critical question is, at which wind load are we allowed to fold the system? Because in the in-between stage, the membrane is not pre-stressed and it totally chaotically moves. There we used a crash simulation software that's used for airbag simulation. Because normally with any software that we use to simulate membrane, we can't simulate the fact that it's touching itself. This kind of contact between elements is very, very difficult to simulate. And there are special software packages from the car industry that can help us to do so. These were linked up to these fluid structure interaction software packages, and then in a very long calculation time, this calculation simulating a couple of minutes of wind would actually take several weeks on a high performance computer. But the result is that we can say we don't just totally play safe and we can only open the umbrella when there's no wind. We actually know from this analysis up to 10, maybe 15 meters per second wind, it's still fine. This is a project we did in our office as structure last year in Switzerland. And that's one of these projects where we used quite heavily this advantage of setting everything up in one grasshopper model, and defining the form finding of the system, defining the FEM program, and linking all of that into the CAD drawings. Even though the system in itself is something that's all but a complex geometry, it's a very classic ridge and valley membrane, 53 meters long, spans over a pedestrian road, it's retractable. And the aspect of having it totally defined parametrically really helped us in placing the geometry within that given boundary condition of this road. So we had a very big problem that some of the adjacent buildings couldn't take very big forces. So we were constantly changing the height of the structure, the span of each individual element, and kind of adapting it until we found a system where the support reactions were minimal. And that's actually quite amazing that in Grasshopper you can't just kind of parametrically define the geometry, but also the topology, that you can change the number of elements as well as their internal geometry. So you're super quick at adapting the system until you find something that's kind of optimal in an architectural sense and also in a structural sense. Another thing we did with this, and this was a first in kinematic membrane systems, is that we chose to use a rail system, which you see down the bottom and here at the top, that's from robotics. So these rails is normally what KUKA robots run on in their workshops. And the advantage is that they can take extremely high load and move at very low friction. Normally in convertible membrane structures, you have two driving systems. You have something that pulls out your membrane, and then you stop, grab the membrane with hydraulic systems, and then tension it. And that's because these rail systems, or whatever the membrane is running on, has so much friction when you start pre-stressing the membrane that you can't move it anymore. And here we cut that out by using these robotic rails, so we could actually move along the rails with an already pre-stressed membrane. That's what you could just see in these images. And also, we could totally avoid having a driving system down the bottom. These bottom sliders, they just simply come along because of the balanced out pre-stress in the membrane. So it's a kind of small little novel aspect that allowed us to move these 53 meters with one single motor and a very kind of thought out cable system that connected these two sides and then pulled them out. And now, something that we always like to do is find our little aspect where we put in kind of high-end engineering, and it might just be in the tiniest detail of a system. It doesn't always have to be something really loud and visible. It could be something as simple as this little detail down the bottom. And I just want to quickly talk about that because it kind of shows you where we come from and where we can do something that we've maybe done at university with students, which was very way out. You know, when we did parametric design with students from ICD, with Achim Menges, you know, we were always aiming for something that's really loud in its expression and really complex. Now here we use it kind of hidden in the system to help us optimize something. We often also talk about material systems. We talk about designing with material behavior. You know, that's something that probably everyone knows. Material system, what is a material system? How do you design with something like that? Now this is something we actually did there. Normally in any membrane structure you have tensioning details at every corner plate because you're not quite sure how to tension the membrane, whether everything is manufactured to size or not. So you always have these turnbuckles, really heavy steel elements in every corner of the system. Here we really didn't want that because we already had these really tightly cut corners and we wanted to remain textile until the very end of the system. So what we did is we produced these belts and tested them for the exact elastic behavior, and we had to test them the way they were sewn. So we did several tests with different sewing seams until we hit it that we could define a kind of stiffness within the belt and thereby define its length. So we can place just one belt instead of a turnbuckle, and then we produce them to different sizes. So first, when we first set up the membrane, we put in a slightly longer belt. Then the system needs to relax over a couple of hours or even days, so the general surface of the membrane can start relaxing into shape. And then we replace them by shorter belts. At the end of the day, that was actually cheaper than buying these stainless steel turnbuckles. And again, you know, it's something very hidden. It might seem totally obvious that we have this belt in the system. You know, no one would question it. You would maybe even rather question why is there this heavy metal piece in the corner. But that's how we like to think and how we like to kind of optimize things that are maybe not even necessary, but at the end lead to a more lightweight and a more clean design. Another question again is, how does the system fold? How can we define what the hanging textile does? You know, it's very easy for us to simulate the textile in its tension state. And I showed you earlier on that we had to use these super heavy software packages to simulate the membrane when it's not tensioned. Now we actually used kangaroo quite a lot of times to simulate a kind of tensioned membrane and then retract it and see how it's hanging, but we really didn't trust it. We thought, like, okay, it's fun, it looks cool, but are we going to dare say that this is the actual lowest point it's coming down to? Because they were going to hang a huge telescreen under the membrane, we had to make sure it doesn't ram into it. So So we're like, okay, kangaroo looks pretty cool, but we're not quite sure. So we actually scaled it to 1 to 27 and a half or something, which exactly fit in the corridor of our old office, and then built it to kind of see. And actually, it came pretty close to what kangaroo did. So that kind of helped. Just to show you the same aspect again for another project, we did this for one of the stadiums of Zaha Hadid. We simulated the membrane, how it's folding, because again, it's something that very few software packages can do. And because we did it for these umbrella systems, we're probably one of the only offices in civil engineering who can kind of simulate it and say it's correct, how this hanging membrane and the retracting membrane is actually going to behave.
Is it the Tokyo one?
Yeah.
You were also still involved? Still?
Just at that stage.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's kind of the kind of few projects that I wanted to share from this aspect of kinematic systems. All of these very easily defined even in Excel or in any other parametric context, because you're just working with geometry. Material behavior may come in when you actually talk about the membrane form finding, but even in tensile membrane form finding, material behavior doesn't matter. At the end of the day, you're form finding minimal surfaces or tension-only surfaces, and the aspect of material behavior only comes in with the aspect of a tension-only surface. Now, the exact stiffness of the membrane only comes in when you do the cutting pattern. So for design, that doesn't really matter. So you can use any of the standard form finding tools, plug them into your grasshopper tool, and you can go ahead. It becomes a lot more complicated when you work with bending, when you actually flexurally deform elements, because then suddenly material behavior is a very decisive factor in the way geometry gets created by boundary conditions. And there's very few analytical descriptions of curves that result from elastic bending. These are called the elastica curves. Euler and Bernoulli did a couple of very complex equations to define them. These are the buckling curves from Euler. Most of the engineers and even architects will know these. And these are the very few curves where we actually have a closed set of formulas to describe the exact geometry of this curve. As soon as you leave this basic 2D geometry, there's no analytical method and no geometrical rule how to define a curvature that results from elastic deformation. So what you need to do is you need to simulate it. And when you're simulating it, it's important to know the exact boundary conditions, know the initial length of each element, and you have to know the exact cross-section and material stiffness. So as part of my PhD, I developed software tools that could use that could define these large elastic deformations in standard civil engineering tools. Because civil engineering software is very good for defining kind of complex geometries, because that's what we deal with a lot. But they're not very good for simulating large deformations. That's not something that we do often. And you will see that a kind of specific software package more than often can't simulate something that it's not sold for, you know, because these are very specific packages. So the software that's very often used, FEM software here in Stuttgart and generally in Germany, Sophistic, has a parametric interface where you can program your own routines in it. So what I did, I programmed a routine that can do incremental load iteration. Basically, it means that you simulate a deformation in increments. Now you do one load case of a little bit of deformation, and then you stack them on top of each other, and thereby you can simulate a very large deformation. This was possible with this tool, and a secondary thing that was very important is to find a method of simulating this deformation very intuitively, because building models of elastic deformation is something that's totally intuitive. You know, you just take two rods and hold their ends and bend them and put them together. And even just because you're bending them like this, you get kind of the rebound effect, you feel it in your hands, so you kind of feel the structural response, and you know how to shortcut forces because you're building the model. So it's actually something that teaches you a lot. And I wanted to kind of find a way to do a simulation method that's very similar to this model building. And to do this, I used these cable elements that normally get used to simulate the edge cables of membranes, because these are elements that can totally elastically change their length. And you can even define a pre-stress level within these cables that makes them contract down to zero length. So what we could do here, and now you will maybe understand this image a little better, is you have two beams, and you say, show me the shape that results from connecting the two ends of the beams. But because they have different lengths, they can kind of sway to the side. And it's quite clear that even in this very simple example, I wouldn't be able to define the final location of the system, where it's going to sway to and how it's going to end up. So I couldn't define this deformation with vectors, where I say I do a support deformation, move from here to here, because I don't know where it's going. So it's a lot more intuitive to just say, take these two points, contract the element in between to zero length, and then it's just like model building. The other aspect, so now you have kind of the simulation ready, that you can do something like model building in FEM. The other aspect is you need to know a lot about different materials and which ones are more adequate or less for these large elastic deformations. These diagrams, all of you will know, the stress-strain diagrams, and basically what you can say, a very steep line is very stiff, and a very shallow line is a very elastic material. I'll repeat this because often that gets confused. On the vertical axis, we have the strength of the material. On the horizontal axis, we have the elongation. And the inclination of this line is the stiffness. And when we want to do large elastic deformations, we're looking for a material with high strength and low stiffness. So we're looking for a line that goes fairly high up on the sigma, but at a very shallow angle. So you can see that pultruded CFRP carbon fiber obviously goes very high up, it's very strong, but it's also a very steep line, so it's maybe not even as adequate for elastic bending. Whereas glass fiber reinforced plastic may have a strength that's higher than steel at a very shallow line, which means it's very elastic. And that's, you know, that's a material behavior that we know. The guy who does the pole vault uses not carbon fiber but glass fiber, because that has this elastic capacity. You can plot these material behaviors on these Ashby diagrams, flexural strength against stiffness, kind of define these lines, and then you can see that several timber materials and fiber reinforced plastics are very good for these elastic deformations. And you'll see that steel is not even that good. Yeah? Steel is below that line, so it means it has a high strength but also has a high stiffness, so you're not going to get much elasticity out of the system. About halfway through my time at the university was when Achim Mengis started lecturing there with the ICD, and quite near the beginning when he came, we sat down together because I was already busy with this bending active subject, and he had just done a couple of similar projects at the AA, and then we said, well, let's do like this bending active subject here with a couple of students. So we did a design workshop, it was called Bend It. And then for one semester, students would just sit there with veneer plywood strips and start bending. And they were just on the search for shortcut systems that result from elastic bending. And we had a kind of internal design competition and decided for this pavilion shape. And then in the next semester, sat together with the same bunch of students, a couple of extra students, and then built it. There were several PhDs involved that were from the Achim Mengis side and from our side at Jan Knippers Institute, and we kind of all sat together. It was a huge group of people. Some of them defined this parametric model. We called it the central information model because it held all the information about the geometry, the cutting pattern of the element, and also the material behavior, which was abstracted from tests and then implemented in this parametric design tool. And that tool could then derive the cutting patterns and the cutout paths for the robot. And it also gave me the initial position of each of these plywood strips and their interconnection points. And with the same cable, elastic cable method, that's actually the first time when I applied it, I could re-simulate the entire erection process of the pavilion. And that was necessary not only to have, you know, a funky image, that was actually necessary for me to know what the internal stresses are. Because I couldn't have just taken the shape that we've derived from Grasshopper and say, now I apply wind to it. Because I wouldn't have had the internal stresses that are a result of this elastic deformation process. So I actually needed to re-simulate the erection process. And that then actually also became the only input for the CAD drawing as a kind of form-finding model, because it actually simulated what we were building. Now, this really helps to understand also what's happening internally in the system. Yeah, I'm cutting out just two of these arches. The kind of basic rule in these arches is that you have two adjacent arches and you connect them in such a way that you always have one connection which is too short and one which is a little bit longer. So it's just like a bow and arrow system. The one that's a little bit too short becomes a tension line and the neighbor goes into, buckles out into a bending deformation. And then I just did a little test and just pretended that I can freeze this geometry and build it without this elastic deformation and place load on it, and then compared the deformation to a system which was elastically deformed. And we found that actually the system which was elastically bent into shape behaves with a higher stiffness. Even though material and geometry were exactly identical, we found that the internal stress state adds to the stiffness of the system. And that was kind of a new thing that initially we couldn't really explain, that then became part of the analysis that I did in my PhD, but that was kind of the first element where we could prove that there is something like a stress stiffening effect also in bending. You just get a couple of more images from the erection process. Something quite nice was once these systems were cut out, we didn't need any plans or any kind of measuring tools on the building site. They were just put into place, and from the elastic deformation, they would find the shape they had to go into. That was a kind of very nice aspect of it. I'm sure some of the locals will know it, or it's been published many times. After this experience with this pavilion, I focused the whole time on these elastic kinetics, which I will show at the end, and parallel to that, focus on different projects where I would just, on non-kinematic or non-kinetic systems, try out a couple of behaviors. And I had a very strong interest in linking this elastic deformation to my knowledge in tensile membrane structures. And this is the kind of this idea of a textile hybrid system, that you put the elastic deformation into equilibrium with the tensile surface pre-stress and kind of find a hybrid that balances elastic deformation with this surface tension. This again, for us engineers, it's a very big challenge in form finding, because now you have to form find the tensile membrane at the same time as form finding the elastic deformation in the beam element. So this is a very simple example, which we could then later apply to more complex systems. I did a couple of projects in this field. I'll just show you the last one we did, again with students from Archimengis. I did this together with Sean Orquist, who's now a professor in Ann Arbor. And we again started off by just giving students material and said, experiment. Just try out to find equilibrium systems where you shortcut now not only bending forces, but you shortcut them with tension in surfaces. And the outcome was open. Yeah? We didn't know what the outcome was going to be. I actually deliberately didn't want to tell students too much about what I've done, because I wanted to find out what the real potentials are. You know, if I, as an engineer, say I want to design something, then it's a bit like playing chess with myself. I'll always make sure that I'll win. Now, when you do something like this, then it's actually a bit scary being an engineer, because you think, like, how the hell am I going to simulate that? But it's cool. It gives you a new challenge, and then we can try to develop tools that can actually simulate this. We had a person in Western France who had this old tower apparently built by Da Vinci, and in his garden in front of the tower he wanted a little pavilion structure. and he invited us to build one of these pavilions that we've done so many times at university. So we went there with students a couple of times to just explore the space, find out what we could build, then went back to Stuttgart, did a long design workshop, and kind of optimized the system over one semester to then return and build it. Very nice aspect was on the second field trip, we did a one-to-one model workshop. Lots of very large elastic glass fiber rods, and we were just kind of building the system in space to find out what's possible one-to-one. And over multiple iterations of model buildings, the students came out with this design of these bent loops that were folded on top of each other, and then you could apply a tension surface to these, to this grid of these bent loops. And you can already see these little tags on these loops. So what we did after form finding it like this and knowing where the connection points are, we took the whole system apart again and drew out what we called a rod map. So each rod in the system was defined in its length and in the positions where it gets connected to any of the other rods. And this could then become again the input for my FEM simulation. But I took all of these rods, I knew where they had to go, knew where they had to connect with any of the adjacent rods, and in multiple sub-steps re-simulated what they'd done in the model. Then you can apply the membrane surfaces to it, and you'll see that the tension in the membrane will add deformation to the system again, to kind of finally become a hybrid of bending deformation and membrane pre-stress. Then, once you've defined it like this in your engineering program, you're then able to do any of the standard steps that we can do with these programs. We can define its geometry, output that into any CAD program, do analysis on it for snow and wind load, and also do the cutting patterns for the membrane surfaces. So now in this project, the FEM software actually became the kind of information model, because that's the only software we could use to define the geometry of the system. There was no way to define it in any kind of grasshopper tool or something, because it had so much to do with the actual real behavior of the rods that we were going to bend. A lot of students often come to me now and say, wow, I can simulate something really cool and grasshopper, kangaroo can do this bending and membrane as well. And when we take it to the next step and want to build it, we often kind of run into a dead end, because using these tools that do particle spring systems help you to find equilibria, they help you to find a geometry that somehow reacts to physics in the model. But it's very difficult to define spring stiffness in this particle spring system that equates to something in real life. Actually, often we found when we tried to work with the real spring stiffness values that the system doesn't converge anymore, and you can't really do the form finding, so you need to trick it somehow. And then when you do something that's really close to reality, then it calculates forever, so you kind of lose this aspect of finding something really fast. So more than often we find that it's a very cool tool as a kind of design idea and finding what we want to design, and then also defining the length in the system to then let that become the input for this FEM software. So with Sean Alquist, what we did is he programmed his own particle spring system, and so what we do is with his software we kind of do first model building by hand, then feed that into a particle spring system to kind of refine it, play with it, make the shape a little bit more precise, and then from that take the data into FEM to do the final form finding. To my knowledge, there's no tool yet that can be a good design tool and a precise simulation tool at the same time. So we do have this aspect that we have to go through multiple design environments. So just a couple of checks that we did. At the top left, that's a guitar string that we bent into this droplet shape. The dotted line is the guitar string, the red line is what we simulated in Sophistic, so you can see that it matches. And on the top right is the kind of 1 to 10 model of this project in France with these 3D scan tags on it, and then comparing that at the bottom to the form finding results in FEM. So we did a couple of tests like this to make sure that what we were simulating had something to do with what we were building. This is now back in France. A total length of each of these droplets is about 36 meters. Total headache to get them into that space without breaking them. So we were shifting them over the roof and placing them in there, making sure that they're not get bent to tighter radius than in their final position. And then finally we had them in place and could add these membrane surfaces. That's always a really revealing moment because these surfaces, they're very unforgiving. It's not this kind of stretch material that you can pull into any shape and it's not going to get wrinkles, it just looks cool. This is actually a polyester PVC membrane with a discrete cutting pattern, and it's only going to work if you hit the form correctly. So that was the kind of, for me, that was the coolest moment in the project when we saw that this edge back here of this Pringle shape really did pop up like it did in the form finding, and we had a kind of wrinkle-free surface. And that's basically what we wanted to prove with this project. It was not so much to show, you know, the next design highlight. It looked a bit weird at the end. But what we could do is we could prove the point that you can totally digitally define and plan something like this to this scale, which kind of hadn't been really possible beforehand. And we built this system at multiple scales. We had these cellular systems that were sitting on the inside as a kind of spring connection between the bottom and top surface, and then built this. At the end, we just called it a equilibrium system. We didn't know what it was. It was something. It stood and it held, but we don't know what it is. All right. So all of this was accompanied by a research project that we did over 4 years at the University of Stuttgart together with material scientists from Denkendorf, they are textile engineers, and with biologists from Freiburg. And we were on the look for kinetic systems without hinges. And we knew from other biologists that there's a lot of plant movements which work without hinges. So they did a lot of research on different types of plant movements. We looked at them together, tried to abstract them and find out the kind of underlying kinetics in these systems, and then started building them. The one that we took the furthest is this flectofin project. That's what I'm going to show you a little bit more about it. It's basically this plant, Strelitzia reginae, which you see at the top, birds of paradise plant. You see it in any flower shop around October. And it's evolutionary optimized to be pollinated by birds. So what it does, it offers this landing platform, and when the bird lands on it, it puts a weight on it. It's called a petal that it stands on, and because of this weight it bends down, and from this bending down the leaves kind of flip to the side, and the pollen gets attached to the bird's foot, bird flies away, plant closes again. And then the biologist come around and gives us these kind of super complex scan images, and we were there scratching our heads like, whoa, this is like super complex mechanics in the system. And we were actually quite blind to the fact that the underlying kinetics are something super simple. It took us about a week to understand that all it is like a stiff backbone with an elastic fin attached to it. And when you bend this backbone, this fin just sways to the side. And that's a mechanism we know. Yeah? Especially engineers, we get taught to avoid it. It's called lateral torsional buckling. It's like, whoa, dangerous, avoid it. We know it also from bridges. These cables that are used to strengthen a beam, we know that we have to place this cable system eccentrically, because otherwise this cable system is just going to flip to the side. And that's actually the mechanism that the plant uses. It just uses it in a controlled fashion. And because it doesn't have a real hinge that has elasticity, it'll always bounce back. And then that's something we could simulate, something we could build, something we optimized again by looking at different leaf structures and understanding how they avoid certain stress concentrations when these systems bend like this. And then finally we simulated it and built it. So this component is entirely made of glass fiber reinforced plastic, and it behaves in this way because of a very defined distribution of stiffness. So this is material behavior enabling kinetics. If the material was composed in any other way, it wouldn't open like this. It's something that you can't define geometrically, it's something that you can only define by understanding how the material behaves. In the beginning, we deployed the system by eccentric hinges, actually, and kind of were bending it like this. And we, in a kind of further project within this research fund, we then developed so-called bending actuators, where we placed shape memory wires in the backbone, and also in other systems which we compared, we placed these car seat heatings. There's car seats that are heated by carbon fiber that's undulated. When you place electric currents to it, it heats up. And if you eccentrically heat up a profile, it starts bending. So you can just put a current to the profile, it starts bending, and then the vector fin will open. That's something that's still part of the research right now at the ITKE. That's one of the first successful prototypes that we built. These are 2.5 meter high lamellas, three of them. And we kind of built this facade mock-up with a company close to Stuttgart that makes facade shading systems. So this one is still deployed by these pistons down the bottom, which causes this eccentric deformation. And then the idea is that maybe this could be a solution to shading these complex glass facades. You know, we have more and more of these very complex double curved surfaces where there's just no solution for any shading element. And obviously, if you have something that helps you shade something on the outside, it's a gigantic advantage for the energy balances of the building. Because, I mean, these facades you probably couldn't even shade on the inside because you don't have anything that can be applied to it. Now, when you have something that works according to elastic deformation, you can deform it, you can place it on any surface, you can make it adapt to the shape that you place it on. So in this project we did quite a few, looked at quite a few different mechanisms. My colleague, the architect who I did this together with, Simon Schleicher, is actually defending his PhD on Monday. It's a public lecture, so anyone who's still here can look at his work. And he went into a lot more of these different kinetic systems, which were all derived of plant movements. This is the opening of the lily flower, and some biologists had found out that the fact that this lily opens like this is only got to do with the fact that the edge of the leaf grows faster than the center. And this faster growing of the edge makes an initially synclastic shape pop open and move into an anticlastic shape. And this we can simulate by G of RP elements where we heat up the edge. You know, you could just place a kind of this car heating element again on the edge. Because you're heating up the edge, it will open like this. So there's a lot of ideas like this where you can translate growing into expansion, and expansion can be triggered by heat, for example. This is a project that we did in 2013 at the International Building Fair in Hamburg. I did this for Knipper-Selbig Engineering Office, and they worked together with KVA Matix from Boston. They'd gotten a kind of a wild card for this building fair in Hamburg. Sheila Kennedy from MIT, she's known for these soft house facades. She developed these PV cells on elastic surfaces and was invited to make a residential building in Hamburg that has one of these soft house facades. Now, they started off with this image at the top, and a few months down the line of discussing this project with German building regulations, got all trimmed back to like a tiny little curtain wall that had to be perfectly controlled and wasn't allowed to move in the wind. And it kind of got reduced to a twisting textile strip. And that's when I got invited back into the project, because they didn't really know how to attach these twisting textiles to the facade. because as soon as you twist it, it shortens. And this shortening of this strip, they didn't want to have a kind of gigantic spring system on either side or something even with motors that they had to control. They wanted something that kind of reacts to it more elastically. So what we did is we placed these glass fiber boards on top of the roof with a little bit of a cantilever, and then attached these twisting textiles to the end, and then that cantilever could always outbalance the deformation in the strip. The strip itself had PV cells cladded to it, and this twisting motion could help the PV cell orient from east to west in the course of the day. And they also wanted some kind of system on the roof where they could change the inclination of the PV cells between winter and summer. So we said, well, let's connect everything into one hybrid again and let the GFRP board on top of the roof bend so we can change the inclination as well, so it kind of becomes one system. So that's what you have. You have these twisting textiles on the facade and on top of the roof, this kind of cantilevering board can be pushed at the back so it pops into this arch, and that controls the inclination of these PVs in the front. So again, it's a form finding question where we start off with a straight element and we simulate how it gets bent onto the roof at the same time as simulating this tension equilibrium in the membrane strip, and then in a secondary simulation with this model that's already been form found, we can simulate the way this arch gets popped up so we can change the inclination of the system on the rooftop. So that's kind of a combination of kinematics in the actuator in the back. That's kind of a very simple kinematic system that gets attached to this kinetic system, which just reacts by elastic deformation. And then again, we have, similar to the project in France, we have this kind of central information model now defined within FEM, which gives us the geometry that we feed back to the CAD drawings, and the architect process them to their facade design. And we then use the model for simulating wind and snow forces and eventually to derive the cutting patterns for the membrane. That's the day before opening. The membrane hadn't been fully pre-stressed yet. That's why you get these little wrinkles here. Actually, we had these little bars that sit in here that get tensioned out, and they put the final pre-stress into the system. So you'll see later images without wrinkles even, because that was always the big question. Can we actually twist a textile without it having wrinkles? And we did a lot of tests with open woven textiles that can change the internal fiber angles and then not wrinkle when they get twisted. This image was actually kind of my favorite shot, when you see how these boards get totally flexed into this arch. And even though the architects and the client knew what we were up to, when they saw this, they got totally scared. They're like, what? It's the first time that as an engineer, an architect told me, are you sure this is going to hold? Usually architects tell us, can we use less columns, can we make it thinner, can we do a larger cantilever? This is the first time that they said, are you crazy? But it works, you know, we can really play with this material behavior. So that's where you see the different motions that this system can go into, different inclinations, and then these twisting strips of textiles. That's, again, before opening, very roughly shot movie that shows you how these elements can twist. All right. The last project I'm going to very briefly show now is something we're doing again at our office. This is a project we're doing for a German energy supplier, EnBW, and they want to build these kind of small umbrella structures with PV cells placed on them. And they were looking for some kind of little thing that they can ship to their clients. Someone who becomes a new client can buy this for very little money and then place it on his balcony, or larger restaurants can maybe buy them. So we wanted to build something that's as simple as a kite that you can buy in the shop, where you can place a PV cell on it. And that does have some intelligence in terms of the kinetics of the system, so you can change the angle of the system and make it orient towards the sun. So again, also we in our office started by building lots of models and making first parametric definitions to define this very simple leaf shape, which can be deformed by two strings that get pulled at a diagonal angle. And just by controlling the tension in this string, you can make it twist and you can make it bend forward. So if you pull the two strings at once, it bends forward. If you only pull one string, it starts twisting. So you have a totally three-dimensional deformation with only two linear driving motors. Doing this with the possibilities of kinematics, doing the same movement with kinematics, you would need about six hinges in the system, which rotate in several different directions to make something that can lean over and twist in all motions. By just using flexibility, you can do it just with kite, with two GFRP rods and two strings, and control the deformation on that. And that's the last project I wanted to show, and I'm going to show the all the different aspects that one can do with kinematics and kinetics. Lots of questions. Or something to drink first.
So if I understand right,
not necessarily, because as soon as you talk about weight in the system as well, and your kinematics work with the weight of it as well, it is kinetics. It's a bit, you know, it's a bit very specific. Everyone uses it however they want. For us, it was very good as a differentiation to say, when are we talking about kinematics is when we talk about hinges, and for us, elastic kinetics is when we talk about these deformations. But kinetics is also when you have centrifugal forces and when you're looking at the, you know, at the mass forces in the system. It doesn't mean that you have to have bending in it. That was just for us a way of differentiating between it, because we mix it, we differentiate it. And different applications.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that's I think that's really market driven for us as an office now. So we totally see that 90% of the convertible membrane structures we do are somewhere in the Middle East, because they need shade and they live in the desert where it's very cold at night, and they want to pull the roof back to make the buildings cool down. So it's like the ideal space for convertible membrane structures. They have a really desperate need for shade, and they have a desperate need for getting rid of the roofs at night. And here, where do we build kinematic structures? You know, it's a couple of stadium roofs, and then the other market is PV. And then obviously there's a lot of applications inside buildings. You know, room partitioning, any kind of adaptive architecture is ideal playground for these elastic kinetic systems. And sure, yeah, working with sound and
might also just be the education.
So yeah.
Like, I think there are not so many, like, I think maybe there's a lot of kinematics and kind of structures and roofs that just bending.
We also work now with car industry a little bit. They have more applications. At university, we had a project with Airbus where we looked at flexible winglets. You know, there's other industries have applications. For architecture, you know, I've kind of noticed that at university, everyone talked about adaptive systems, but then in real projects, that's the first thing that gets cancelled when you're building something. It's like, yeah, keep the shape, it looks cool, but we can't make it move. Too expensive.
What happened before?
Yeah. I think it's kind of system inherent. It's with kinematics, you can win competitions, but you can't more than often you can't realize it. It's a shame. And I mean, that's an aspect that we're actually trying to sell, is that in these elastic systems, the costs lie in the design and not so much in the execution. Because in the execution, this is super cheap. It's a straight GFRP element. And it's just about knowing how to place it in your system and how to bend it. And knowing that you can engineer it. You know, in these umbrella structures that we build in Saudi, one of these Teflon hinges that lies in these arms costs a fortune. You know, we don't have hinges here. We don't have maintenance.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Is there, do you know if there's research or about using other materials that have this properties?
Yes. I mean, it was a huge question for us. And at the IDKE, there's a lot of research about natural fibers and biopolymers, and there was two PhDs just finished just on that aspect. And in a way, we had to see that the actual industry isn't far enough to give us alternatives. For anything that's non-kinematic or non-kinetic in that case, timber is perfect. Problem with timber is it relaxes. So when we took apart that pavilion that I showed you, the arches had these bends in them, which basically means you couldn't make something kinetic with it. It wouldn't flex back after a while, which is stay in that shape. So as a kind of cheap way to build complex geometry, active bending is perfect, but you're gonna freeze that shape. Anything that's kinetic, I don't really know an alternative to GFRP. Spring steel is very expensive and doesn't have kind of the design freedom in it. But something that we did to kind of have an understanding of what we're talking about is we did a comparison of different kinetic systems and evaluated for them for their environmental impact. I don't know if you guys know the project we did with Knippers-Helbig in Yosu at the expo in Korea. We built a very large facade for the One Ocean Pavilion with Soma Architects, with a whole array of these bent arches. And that was a very cool project because we designed three alternative systems. We designed one of these flectofin systems, and we designed what was actually built, these GFRP planks that were just elastically bent like this, and then an alternative totally made in steel. And all three systems were designed to very high detail. So we actually had all the numbers. We knew how much steel we need how much GFRP we need. And then you get these online databases where you can put in your material and you can evaluate it for the kind of seven main environmental impacts, like it's got to do with the production, with the manufacturing, and with the shipping of your material, and then you know different factors about the groundwater, the ozone, and CO2 emission, and all of that. And if you compare 1 kilogram of steel against 1 kilogram of GFRP, then GFRP sucks. Yeah? It's terrible. But when you compare it in a system, we could see that our steel alternative was going to be 10 times more heavy than what we built in GFRP. And now if you compare that, if you compare 1 kilo of GFRP against 10 kilogram of steel, then actually GFRP is better because you have so much less material. That was kind of a, you know, it doesn't always work, but in that case we could prove the point that if you work intelligently with that material, then you get away with it. It's not fantastic, but it's, you know, it's okay. Yeah. For now.
I have one more question. It's not related that much with what you specialize in. But for example, in case of this single family house, mm-hmm. how does the control over this this whole shading system looks like? Is it fully automatized,
mm-hmm.
or does the user turns it on and off?
You always need both. In our research project, we worked with this industrial partner, and in the beginning, we were always spinning out about, wow, these totally autonomous systems which react to the sun and open and close, and they always said, no. You always need user interaction. It's like maybe a train station or an airport hall could have a shading system which is totally autonomous, but even an office tower can't have that. So you always need this option of interaction. And in this soft house case, it has an automated drive where, you know, it always optimally traces the sun. But then you can trigger it as well.
But still apart from this, from user controlling the shading system, the shading system reacts to weather.
Yeah, but by sensors.
Just for safety reasons, the user also has the possibility to override this. Primary automatic control.
That's always the big idea, isn't it? That you can say, wow, thermal expansion, thermal heating, you could cause expansion, and then expansion could make your system drive. But then at what temperature do you produce it? At what temperature do you build it? A hot day in winter, a hot day in summer, that somehow doesn't work. So what we found with these car heating systems, that we had a pretty good translator in it. So you place PV cells on your shading elements, and when they produce electricity, you can make that connect to this car heating system. And then your PV cell is both energy source and sensor. Because a lot of sun means a lot of electricity, means a lot of heating of your car heater, meets a lot of deformation. So that works, but because it's going through an electric system, it's something that you can intervene. Something you can kind of say, no, actually I don't want this, so make the electricity not go into the profile, but make it go somewhere else. That's the idea which we found could work the best, but it hasn't been tested industrially. It's only kind of prototypes.
And where is this house located?
In Hamburg. It's actually it's a commercial project. People live there. At first, you know, I mean, obviously there was a whole ton of problems that we had to deal with because something like this hadn't been done. And there was very small budget, and this deal was executed at a very low budget, and a lot of things are very questionable even about the project. But for us, it was a complete milestone to say, you know, obviously we can do something crazy with students, but can we do something like this and run it past the officials in Hamburg? And then the craziest thing is that membrane structures have no design codes in Germany. So you always need a special case approval, which is very expensive. Now the GFRP boards on the top definitely have no design codes, and especially not when you flex them like that. But we found a product from a Danish company which had a product approval in Germany. It has it's allowed as a building product in Germany, and had just gotten that approval. So in the end of the day, we could use these GFRP boards on top of the roof without any special case approval. But for these membrane strips, which are like the simplest thing ever, we needed a really expensive tests and proof engineers and all of that. But it was, you know, there was a huge fight. We were fighting for 1.5 years to get this thing there. And it was, you know, even in Korea, it was a lot easier to build something like that. They're into innovation, and Hyundai took on the project, and they said, well, we're going to do it, and it doesn't matter if we don't have codes, we just do it. In Germany, impossible. So it was, you know, it was cool that we at least got this far. We know the tricks now.